Good evening, I'm Peter Jennings, and this hour is about Ross Perot, about who he is and what he might be like if he becomes the president, which he may.
People have been trying to get me into politics since 1969, when somebody ran a poll that showed that if I would run for governor, I'd be elected. I've never had any interest in, I don't mean to demean people in public life.
Ross Perot on Ross Perot in 1984.
It's terribly important in this world to know what you can do, to know what you can't do, and play to your strengths. Well, my strengths, if I have any, are in business, not in public life.
Did political office never appeal to him?
Not a bit, not even for a minute. I would be a square peg in a round hole. I can do a better job as a private citizen operating with other private citizens. I'm better outside the tent than in the tent.
There are a lot of Americans who apparently believe that Ross Perot should stay outside the tent, that it's altogether too dangerous to elect him as the nation's political ringmaster. And yet, almost without lifting a finger, let alone participating in the traditional political primary system, and openly declaring his disdain for the country's two main political parties, Ross Perot in this summer of 92 is the man to beat. It began publicly as a challenge on the Larry King Show.
Is there any scenario in which you would run for president?
Well, number one, I don't want to.
I know, but is
number
there a scenario?
Number two, if you're that serious, you, the people, are that serious, you register me in 50 states.
I was so surprised, and he said, oh, don't worry, you know, it's not going to happen. It was just a hypothetical sort of thing.
And yet it has happened with a vengeance. One man with no party who millions of people believe is the solution to their problems.
If you can live with the way things are today, don't vote for me.
I don't think I'm mistaken about this guy. I sense in him true patriotism, the truest kind.
I think Ross Perot is probably a fascist.
I think there's a lot more to being president than simply having a lot of opinions.
He has practical answers to difficult problems.
If you want me, then I will go as your servant. If you find somebody else you like better, that's fine with me too.
Good evening, Parole Petition Committee.
He gets you fired up, doesn't he?
In the first 15 days of operation, according to the phone company, Ross Perot's phone bank got more than 1 million phone calls. People who say they've been abandoned by their government.
Your numbers are growing. The enthusiasm is growing. And again, just in plain Texas talk, they ain't seen nothing yet.
He strikes me as a can-do man. And when he says he can do it with our help, anything and everything can be taken care of.
I really don't believe Ross Perot has anything to offer black America or middle-class America.
We're just regular people, and I like the fact that he speaks to me. When I listen to him, he's talking to me.
It's time to pick up a shovel and go clean out the barn.
We get to know who Ross Perot is as a human being and who he's been as a businessman, the less appealing he'll be to a diverse spectrum of American voters.
I'd much rather try and see someone who's not going to run with the political system, but maybe run against it and start running with the American people.
It has become an electronic love affair. Ross Perot on every talk show.
Number two, are you a billionaire or trillionaire?
I'm just working from day to day, Dave.
And some of the faithful talking back on home video.
We are Gordon and Marianne Peck, just an ordinary couple that have lost confidence in our United States government.
Can we get a little more integrity back into our government? Thank you.
Everybody's accusing me of buying the election. My reply to them is, that's right.
Let me put it this way. He's spending his money, not ours. The other guys spend our money like it was water, and they've been doing it for years.
At first, they pretended he wasn't really there.
It's like the less he does, the higher he goes in the polls.
Now they can't ignore him.
Ross Perot is a false solution to our problem.
And my reply there is, oh no, because to know me is to love me.
But do we really know him?
Out in grassroots America, they're not interested in those issues. This phone bank just roars day after day after day. Why are you wasting time coming up with platforms, Perot? Both parties have been coming up with platforms for decades, and neither party ever implemented them.
I like his principles. And as long as we got principles like that in charge, why, I don't care about the details.
If they were to elect him on the basis of what we know now, we could be in for some big surprises.
Peter Jennings reporting, Who is Ross Perot? Brought to you by Sprint, not just another phone company.
One of the most difficult election year is to sift the fact from the fiction. So often in politics, image is accepted as reality. We're going to begin by looking at the way Ross Perot, and in this case his son Ross Jr., do business, and how they manage to make such vast sums of money. It is important to consider that Mr. Perot is campaigning for the presidency in part by attacking the special interests, which he says have captured so much of Washington's agenda. this report from ABC's John Martin about how the Perots built the Alliance Airport in Fort Worth, Texas, a very complex process which required persuading local, state, and federal governments, makes it clear that in Fort Worth and in Washington, Mr. Perot was considered a very special interest.
Maintaining world prominence in this quickly changing economy is today's challenge. It is the reason for Alliance.
Alliance Airport is now open and ready for business. This great airport was conceived and executed in a fraction of the time it normally takes to build a large-scale airport. It is a classic compliment to the Texas can-do spirit.
Actually, Alliance is more a compliment to Ross Perot's can-do spirit and his ability to get the system to work to his advantage. Alliance is a 16,000-acre business venture in Fort Worth. The Perots are predicting that it could become the international industrial gateway to 21st century America. It also stands to make Ross Perot and his family, including his son, Ross Jr., who runs the Alliance project, even more fabulously wealthy than they already are.
We call it Alliance really for one reason. This is a giant partnership between the private sector and the public sector. We're going to put you on this side.
Ross Perot Jr. likes to take visitors on helicopter tours of Alliance to show them the land he and his father donated for the airport. It was valued at about $12 million. But the taxpayers have contributed nearly $120 million to build the airport complex. From this alliance, the Perots stand to gain hundreds of millions of dollars from developing the vast amounts of land they still own surrounding the airport. To move Alliance through the bureaucracy, the Perots spent $3 million assembling a team of more than two dozen engineers, lawyers, and lobbyists. They overwhelmed city government in Fort Worth.
They push, because they got investment out there, and they say, how do we make this work? How do we, you know, how do we move this program faster?
One night we rustle cattle, 1,000 head or so.
In a city that still has a sleepy western atmosphere, Fort Worth wasn't used to the Perot's aggressive style.
With an outlaw band, the names are known quite well.
The city found itself confronted by a Perot team that wanted decisions, not deliberations.
As the project developed, the city council here found itself swept along by the sheer force of the Perot organization. The Perot team had no hesitation about using its power and influence to get things done, and it made it clear it was not interested in government as usual.
I think any time you're dealing with Mr. Perot, he's clearly a man of action, a man of direction, and a person who is clearly focused on what the objective is. And we didn't spend a lot of time small talking.
There weren't any shouting matches, there weren't any shoving matches, there were just some strong, sincere discussions. And sometimes they would go to Washington to try to see if they could overrule, and it never happened.
So they tried to go around you?
Oh, sure.
The Perots went to Jim Wright, then the Speaker of the House of Representatives. Wright made the airport, which was in his district, a top priority. He pushed through a bill ordering the FAA to spend $25 million on Alliance, the maximum for timely completion of the project. A victory for Ross Perot.
He understands the system and uses it very, very well. I know some other people do it as well, but I don't know anybody does it better.
Just when the deal was about to go through, the Perots and their lawyers presented a management contract that might have cost Fort Worth millions of dollars if it hadn't been for a cowboy businessman on the city council who read the fine print.
Woo, baby.
Steve Marin owns a ranch west of Fort Worth. He was a councilman when the Perot group told the city it wanted to manage the airport. The Perot lawyers even drew up an agreement they presented as fair to both sides.
I finally took the contract home and read it myself, and it just had too many tricks in it.
The contract initially called for a 200-year lease, which would have been longer than the Republic, about four times the length of aviation history in our country.
I said, my God, Ross, the United States is only 205 or 6 years old. I said, I'm not going to put into perpetuity giving something away for 6 generations down to your great-great-grandchildren.
It was an agreement that was a good agreement, but it was too complicated.
200 years? Isn't that a long time to hold a city?
Looking back on it, I certainly wouldn't have done it because I didn't realize at the time it was going to be that controversial. So in the future, I'll probably make that mistake again.
He had enough influence over the city council to where they didn't look at the big picture, they didn't look at the bottom line, they didn't look at how much it was going to cost the taxpayers. They just said, if Perot wants it, it must be good.
Reed Pigman sounds like many people who have lost to Ross Perot. He runs a nearby airport. He lost when he bid against the Perots to manage Alliance and found the city extending the time of competition, allowing the Perots to make a better offer.
The lesson, I would think, is that he'll do anything to get what he wants.
What have you
I'm not saying anything illegal. He'll go after it until he gets it.
I don't see him as a vindictive person.
You've never seen him go after somebody who was opposing him?
No. Now, certainly in competitions, business competitions, he'll work very hard to win the competition. But I don't see him, he doesn't hold grudges, he doesn't go after people.
He doesn't send out detectives?
No, he's a bigger person than that. In what sense? On a business competition? Certainly. I have sent, on some of my projects, and some of the times that I've been sued, I have sent detectives out to understand and uncover the facts.
In the end, the Perots got what they wanted, fast. Only 18 months from groundbreaking to opening day. Since then, American Airlines has built a giant maintenance facility on land it bought from the Perots. Other private firms and federal agencies are buying in. With government so involved in a private venture, this creates profits and a paradox for a businessman turned candidate.
Your father has been critical of what he calls the capturing of Congress by special interests. Isn't this really an example of that very same kind of capturing of the public interest?
So we don't think so. I think of every public program was funded the way this program was funded, we probably wouldn't have a deficit in the United States.
And I hope we can work out a responsible plan.
Earlier this year, in his budget proposal to Congress, George Bush praised Alliance. But as Ross Perot began campaigning for the presidency, the Bush administration began having second thoughts. The FAA has put on hold its decision to allocate another $108 million to expand the airport.
Now, the only thing that's been accomplished by holding up Alliance Airport is the Republicans are shooting themselves and shooting their friends.
Ross Perot says the FAA's action is completely political. I can't
believe it. My review of this has absolutely nothing to do with that.
The acting FAA administrator, Barry Harris, says the delay at Alliance is not related to Perot's political aspirations. Harris visited the airport last year.
I got the obligatory helicopter tour that everyone who goes out there gets.
Did he ask you to do anything for him?
He said that they were looking at a runway extension. And I kind of chuckled because they just opened the runway they had. But I promised that I would keep an eye on that application, and I have.
So the Alliance Airport is a symbol of the Perot's ability to get things done, but a symbol, too, of how the system Ross Perot used so well is turning against him now that he is running for president.
Whatever happens at the Alliance Airport, for many Americans, Ross Perot is the classic American success story because he's gone from having little to control of such a large fortune. His critics say it never would have happened had he not been so smart at working the system which he now criticizes. But he's also enormously popular because he's come to be portrayed as a man of action, the billionaire who cares so passionately about the fate of men who have gone overseas to serve his company, or much more importantly, men who have gone to serve the country and ended up in trouble, that he will even go outside the system to save them. Here's ABC's John McQuethy.
This is one quiet corner of Washington that Ross Perot can claim as his own. The statue, which he lobbied for years to be placed here, honors those who fought in Vietnam. To Perot, Vietnam and the American soldiers he believes are still prisoners there have been both a patriotic cause and an obsession that has shaped his life.
Can we agree that when you send these wonderful people out on the battlefield, everybody in this country goes with them in spirit? Yeah. And can we finally agree that you never leave one behind just because it's political?
23 years ago, during the Vietnam War, the young, already wealthy businessman chartered a plane on Christmas Eve and tried to deliver turkeys and gifts to American prisoners of war in North Vietnam. He failed.
The United States belongs to its people, and each person in the United States has an obligation to do whatever he can within his limits to make it a better country.
After the Vietnam War ended, 1,400 POWs came home. But Perot refused to believe that everyone had been freed.
He traveled once to Hanoi himself and over the years spent hundreds of thousands of dollars sending soldiers of fortune into the jungles of Laos and Vietnam. Perot hoped to find proof that those who were listed as missing and whose names had already been chiseled on this wall as dead were in fact still alive.
So intense was his belief that Perot would listen to anyone, including those the U.S. government regarded as frauds. Todd Mason wrote a biography of Perot.
He funded a lot of them. He, as I remember it, offered as much as $4 million for various pieces of evidence.
But is he being conned? He's a smart man.
He's a smart man, but Ross Perot could be conned, and this is one of the areas in which he can be conned.
Perot goes beyond just believing some Americans are still prisoners in Vietnam, though President Reagan gave him unprecedented access to all the secret files. Perot accused the U.S. government of covering up evidence. It's all an effort to hide what he claims was CIA involvement in drug dealing in Southeast Asia during and after the Vietnam War. At the center of that conspiracy, as Perot saw it, was then Assistant Secretary of Defense Richard Armitage. Perot hired an investigator to go after him. In a bitter fight that included allegations about Armitage's private life, Perot tried unsuccessfully to get Armitage fired and indicted. Congressman Stephen Solars heads a subcommittee that has investigated the Perot allegations.
But so far, all I've heard are monstrous allegations without any specifics. And when the specifics are requested, they sort of fade away into the ether.
The idea that there could be a conspiracy that would run for 10 years and would not somehow end up being leaked to someone's favorite reporter, I just reject out of hand.
Bobby Inman, while serving as deputy head of the CIA, sent secret missions into Vietnam long after the war to check out reports of live prisoners.
There are too many of us who lost friends in Vietnam to ever have tolerated a cover-up in the process if there had been the slightest evidence that a cover-up existed.
Certainly he hasn't identified the existence of any American POWs who may still be in Indochina. He clearly hasn't brought any back.
It was in Iran that Perot established his reputation for daring rescues during the middle of the revolution in 1979.
We were successful in our efforts to arrange with revolutionary leaders in the area to have the prison stormed by an Iranian mob.
Using a private band of commandos, Perot smuggled out of Iran two of his employees who had been thrown in jail by the Iranian government. It was a triumph for Perot that was turned into a television movie and best-selling book on Wings of Eagles, written by Ken Follett.
He made the decision to go to Iran, and I think that's probably a typical Perot decision. It was risky. It wasn't foolhardy. There was a measured risk and a measured benefit, and he decided to take the chance. He decided to be bold.
Ross, God, I can't believe you're here.
To be sure that his image was presented just that way, Perot dictated exactly how the story would be told.
The terms were Perot was in charge, meaning if Perot didn't like the manuscript, he paid back the advance and everyone went home. As it was, he worked over the manuscript three times with a number two pencil.
After rescuing his own employees from Iran, Perot made it clear he would provide large sums of money to the Reagan administration for secret counter-terrorist operations. His offer allowed the White House to legally bypass requirements that it tell all to Congress. 1981, when American General James Dozier was kidnapped by terrorists in Italy, Perot provided $500,000 for ransom. The money was never needed. During Lebanon's civil war in 1986, with the life of American hostage Peter Kilburn hanging in the balance, White House aide Oliver North tried to bribe a terrorist in hopes of freeing Kilburn. Perot provided the money.
Our government wasn't able to do that. The money was conduited as with Mr. Perot's assistance and one of his personnel out to Cyprus, where the transaction was conducted.
$200,000 of Perot's money was lost, and Peter Kilburn was murdered. To try to pay ransom for other hostages in Lebanon, Perot offered North an additional $2 million in cash. Even though the money was never used, Perot did get something for his effort.
You know, there's kind of a mutual, abuse in that direction by governments and people like himself. People like Mr. Perot make themselves available, and they get used, and they expect favors in return.
Perot was rewarded with special access to the White House, which in turn gave him powerful new status on the Vietnam POW issue so close to his heart. Using that status, Perot went to Vietnam in 1987 to negotiate for more information. It turns out he also used that visit to establish new business contacts with Vietnam, something the White House was later stunned to find out. Perot says it was the Vietnamese who pushed the business contacts, not him. Whatever the explanation, there is no doubt that Ross Perot for 20 years used his wealth to try to win freedom for Americans being held overseas. For some, that makes him a hero. But for others, his passion in some cases has left questions about how he operated.
So in these adventures, what are the clues to Ross Perot as the leader of a nation? If he were president, would he encourage private businessmen to conduct covert missions in other countries? Would he encourage them to spend their own money, thus circumventing Congress's power of the purse? We'll be right back.
Peter Jennings reporting, Who is Ross Perot? We'll continue in a moment.
One of the things about Ross Perot which many people find so appealing is that he has not been, to pick up on his own phraseology, tainted by politics, which is not to imply that he doesn't have any experience in public policy. 9 years ago, he ran a sophisticated political campaign to fix what he regarded as serious flaws in Texas education. There is no doubt that Perot sees education as the key to America's competitiveness. And in Texas, when he believed the state was paying attention to the wrong competition, there was no stopping him. Here's ABC's Cokie Roberts.
Organized sports, the marching band, the pep squad, the 4-H groups, and all other forces such as these dominate some of our schools.
In 1983, Ross Perot kicked off a crusade for education and turned Texas tradition on its head. He took on all the Lone Star State holds holy, even the hallowed sport, high school football. Under Perot's edict, failing students were yanked from the team. No pass, no play.
We have allowed our school in many places across Texas to become primarily places of play and secondarily places of learning.
That commission tackled the Texas sacred cows. And Friday night football, high school football in Texas is a sacred cow. I know the rest of the country may not understand that, but that's the way it is here.
Ross Perot not only endangered sacred cows, he took on chickens, too, ridiculing kids who missed school to show their prized livestock.
I have a documented case of one child that spent 35 days going across Texas with a chicken. Everybody always wants to know why'd he come home. The chicken was worn out. It's simple, you know. Yeah, it's just...
One of the things he did was came in and sat down. He said, I need a spreadsheet, you know. They said, a spreadsheet on education. Well, the educator said, what's he talking about?
Larry Askoff has known Perot since the late 1960s when the two men worked together to improve inner city schools in Dallas.
What Russ wanted to do was look at all the money that was being spent, you know, $1 billion in education in this state, and you know, how much we spend on reading, how much we spend on math, how much we spend on kindergarten, and then looking at the results and saying, well, are we getting our money's worth?
Step one is to get the facts. Step two is to assemble these facts. We're going to be sending teams of auditors across the Texas school system. These will be from the big eight CPA firms. I want to know where all this money goes.
He seemed to have an agenda at the very beginning that tends to be his own thoughts on how to change things. And as long as everybody agreed with those thoughts, everything was fine. But if we wanted to do something else, there really wasn't a compromise.
Schools might have been the subject of education reform, but to learn his subject, Ross Perot refused to go by the book. Instead of talking to teachers, he hired consultants, decided what he thought was best for Texas education, and then went to the business community and citizens groups to sell his plan.
The most important thing is to get down in the ring and slug it out and don't back off. In the words of the Dallas News, this is no time to get rabbity.
Much of the plan, such as smaller class sizes and a preschool program for disadvantaged four-year-olds, met with widespread approval.
Come on.
But other aspects faced stiff opposition. Coaches resisted the no pass, no play rule.
We are opposed to passing off.
Why?
In our opinion, it's not realistic, Dr. Fleming. I don't think they'll take the challenging courses.
That's what you're saying. There's something, you know, if God gives you fast feet, he gives you a slow head.
And teachers took great offense at the requirement that they take literacy tests.
Very angry. I felt that my time had been wasted. All of my energy, my parents' money for sending me to college. I felt like that if I had not been prepared, why hire me?
Despite the teachers' unions, Perot was able to push through education reform with methods that could prove instructive were there to be a president Perot.
Basically, people were expecting him to lobby the legislature directly, and he went around them and went to the business people of the state who pay the bills and elect people, you know, and sold them. And they obviously turned around and talked to the people they sent to Austin and said, doesn't that make sense, Joe?
Plus, Perot spent more than $1 million of his own money to hire the highest-priced lobbyists.
In the state of Texas, if you want to get a statute passed, if you want to get laws passed, if you want to get things done, there's a saying that you hire the right lobbyist. And He did that because he hired them all.
Inside this chamber, legislators accustomed to the subtle game of playing off special interest found themselves mowed down by a green wave of well-paid lobbyists and grassroots activists, all organized by that outsider, Ross Perot, playing the ultimate inside sport.
Ross doesn't call himself an outsider or an insider or anything else. He says, here's where I stand. Here's who I am.
Here's where I stand, and Perot's critics add, this is what I want, or else.
He wanted his stamp put on it for reasons I think are becoming clear. I think he's had an agenda for a long time greater than just being a public service as a volunteer task force leader. And if I can improve education, it's a great thing. But while he was there, it got done, and anyone that stood in the way hardly got the key to the restroom any longer.
Getting it done, argue Perot's supporters, is what counted.
You got to go in at the top and clean this thing up.
School reform was accomplished, and most Texas observers agree that without it, education in the state would have surely gotten worse.
And they underestimated the tenacity of H. Ross Perot.
But the governor who appointed the school commission, Mark White, felt the wrath of the teachers in the next election. He lost. And as for Ross Perot?
He got the praise, but not the blame.
He won, and he won big time. I think he, you know, he whipped us like a tied-up goat.
He won and added to the legend of Ross Perot as the man to turn to get things done.
That football coach there who said Ross Perot whipped them like a tied-up goat is a reminder that Mr. Perot has brought to the presidential campaign some very colorful, simple language. Too simple for many people who believe they are hearing from him simplistic proclamations about very complicated problems. We'll take a closer look at some of those declarations of his later on, but for now we turn to our reporter Jeff Greenfield. And to paraphrase a national cliche, Ross Perot believes that what was good for General Motors in the 1980s is good for the country today, namely Perot.
Right now, when I look at my country, I feel like I'm looking at General Motors during that period of time. Now, why was I not successful at General Motors? I was just one person and surrounded by people who wanted the status quo.
The status quo had served General Motors well for decades. But by 1984, the company knew the ground under its empire was trembling.
Ladies and gentlemen, may I present to you Mr. Roger B. Smith.
Board Chairman Roger Smith was convinced that without radical change, especially technological change, GM would be unable to compete effectively. And, Smith believed, that change simply would not come from within. So the $83 billion giant looked south, to Dallas, to a company that seemed to symbolize a gung-ho, can-do spirit, Electronic Data Systems, EDS, its founder, H. Ross Perot. Journalist Daron Levine wrote a book on Perot and GM.
And what really iced the cake for Roger Smith was when he met Ross Perot, because this was the kind of guy who he really envied, somebody who could deal out of his hip pocket, somebody who could make things happen quickly, somebody who didn't really have to deal with a massive kind of bureaucracy that he faced at General Motors.
In 1984, General Motors agreed to buy EDS for more than $2.5 billion in stock. Of that, Perot received nearly $1 billion. That made him General Motors' biggest shareholder and earned him a seat on the board of directors.
The driving force behind our decision to enter into this agreement with General Motors,
GM agreed to let EDS keep its separate identity and to keep Ross Perot in charge. He was confident that he and Smith could work together.
I don't expect to be shackled or hobbled in any way.
And so the self-made, self-starting, seat-of-the-pants entrepreneur from Dallas sent his EDS team up north to Detroit, into the heart of the largest industrial corporation in the world, where structure, process, doing it by the book were watchwords. It was a mix that worked about as well as Texas oil and Great Lakes water. And it wasn't long before Perot began to feel that GM was breaking its promise of autonomy, interfering in everything from bookkeeping to salaries. But those disputes paled beside the real trouble, The company's biggest stockholder was asking some very hard questions about what was happening all over General Motors and why. One of the people Perot questioned was industry analyst Marianne Keller.
What kind of cars are people buying? Why aren't we making the cars that people are buying? When one explores the answer to those questions, you begin to peel away the onion and you discover things about an organization that is incapable of listening to the voice of the consumer.
Perot began to behave as a self-appointed one-man troubleshooter. For example, he paid a highly unusual visit to GM's Arlington, Texas plant. UAW official David Perdue remembers.
That was really something to the people out here. The fact that he came out here and actually sat down and ate out of a sack lunch with them on the shop floor and just walked up and down the line and some occasions just took over the jobs. That they showed him how to do some of the jobs out here. And so he just, for a day or two, he just became an assembly line worker, one of the guys.
And more, Perot was beginning to go public with what he said he had found, a sickness within the corporation itself.
Let's cut out the authoritarian management. Let's cut out all this structure. Let's cut out all these things that separate people.
The executives, he argued, were up there on the 14th floor, insulated, isolated, looking down, literally and symbolically, on their dealers, their workers, even their customers. In Perot's view, GM had forgotten what it was all about.
All this may have made Perot something of a hero to GM workers on the assembly line, but some industry watchers found it more self-serving than a public service.
Those of us that cover the auto industry never heard specific recommendations other than an awful lot of simplistic slogans and things like getting rid of heated garages and company executive dining rooms. We were looking for substance, and instead, all too often, we would hear just a lot of very catchy slogans.
In the midst of one boardroom dispute, Perot sent a stinging letter to Roger Smith, using language the board chairman had likely never heard from another director. "You need to know," wrote Perot, "that your style intimidates people. Losing your temper hurts GM. GMers at all levels use terms like ruthless and bully to describe you." Increasingly, Ross Perot was turning up the heat on Roger Smith in public, in the press, a tactic that infuriated most members of the GM board.
You criticize the management, criticize the cars, criticize everything that's done, what I call instant expert kind of stuff. You know, go talk to three people in the plant, talk to three dealers, and come up and make a press conference.
It became clear that something had to give, and it wasn't going to be General Motors. So in December of 1986, Smith and the board bought out Perot and his allies. He left the General Motors board, left EDS, the company he had founded 17 years earlier. The price of the buyout? Some $700 million. But for all of that money, Perot claimed he did not want to leave. So he launched one last public relations offensive.
Yeah, I've got to say to the board, I said, wait a minute, look at this again. Think what $700 million will buy inside this corporation to build it and strengthen it, and make sure you want to do this.
If Perot had been hoping for a groundswell of support, that groundswell never came. Mort Meyerson, former president of EDS, has been a top Perot aide for more than 20 years.
So it's very clear to me that Ross spotted very early in the game what needed to be done, and it's taken 5.5 years to get there. However, with the board as it sat at that time, and with the chairman and the CEO as it was at that time, it simply wasn't possible. Solomon couldn't have come up with a way to make that work.
Oh, I think Ross Perot's style, as I saw it at General Motors and then later as we're seeing it now, is that of a Lone Ranger. He's kind of riding up the hill on the white horse, and he plans to solve the ills of first then the world's largest corporation and now the largest nation in the world.
Ultimately, the voters will have to decide the meaning of Perot's involvement with General Motors. Does it show him as a visionary with the courage to take on bureaucracies, or as a man long on rhetoric and short on specific solutions?
Two quotes from Ross Perot to go on with. The greatest thing he once said that would break my heart is if I got there and could not do the job for the American people. He also said once that he was going to lay out his positions on a variety of issues because, as he put it, the media apparently can't breathe without it. We'll take a deep breath and come right back. We come now to a problem that millions of people have with Ross Perot that millions of others profess not to care about. Where does he stand on the issues? What's his program for governing the nation? Mr. Perot says often that his principles are more important. Nonetheless, by way of example, here is what he has to say on gun control.
Pretty simple. I grew up here in Texas. We all had guns, but we didn't shoot one another. We have one problem with weapons now. It's not people who collect weapons. It's not people who own weapons. It's people who do drive-by shootings. It's people who wander into 7-Elevens and blow up everybody in the store. So the challenge in our country is to get the guns out of the hands of the violent people.
On economic growth.
We now have a declining job base that gives us a declining tax base, that gives us an ever-increasing number of welfare users which eat into the declining tax base. We have got to stabilize the declining job base and stop the decline, turn it around, and have a growing dynamic job base.
On race relations.
Now, we are a melting pot. We come from all over the world. Now it's fashionable to sit around and whine that we all didn't come from the same place, don't have the same background, same race, same religion. Historically, that's been a great strength. We have figured out how to turn it into a weakness and an excuse. We have got to make the melting pot work and play to its strengths, and we have all got to link arms together in order to have a nation that works together as opposed to a nation in factions that fights with one another.
The thing about Ross Perot on the issues is that he is so often right on the money, and yet so often all he has done is define the problem. Of course the challenge is to get the guns out of the hands of violent people. Of course new jobs have to be created. Of course, racial diversity should give the nation strength. Ross Perot is common sense itself. Take guns away from the killers, expand the job base, love thy neighbor. It is the getting from here to there that has so many Americans concerned. Let's call it the how factor. How, for example, is he going to end the hate? And the most important how would he govern? For now, we leave you to consider the judgment of the closest thing we have to experts on Ross Perot and the presidency.
He'll be bold. He won't be cautious. He will look at America's problems, and he will do something. That's very much in his character. He's a guy who hates to say, we can't do anything about that problem. He just hates to say that. He will have a go.
He is a radical revisionist. He's somebody who is fundamentally very wary of democratic processes. It gets in the way of how he would operate as a national boss. He has a very authoritarian manner. He has authoritarian methods. And his idea of government is authoritarian.
I think if he gets to be president, it can go either way. It's going to scare everybody so bad, maybe they'll tighten up the ship.
I do find nothing in my experiences with Ross Perot that would suggest to me that he's unqualified to be president of the United States. Precisely the opposite. We are a country in some trouble. We need leadership, we need action, and we need a doer.
Well, of course, I've been accused of cutting through red tape in ways that aren't altogether pleasant as some would have had them. He is obviously a man who wants to cut through red tape. He doesn't appear to have much tolerance for bureaucracy. Quite frankly, it is one of the things that makes me wonder how he would be able to handle this city. Washington, D.C. is a city of bureaucracy.
Well, you know, Ross would deal with bureaucracies in the same way he does everything else. He's a very results-oriented guy. He would understand that you have to deal with the bureaucracy. I don't think he'd surrender. And I imagine there'd be a tiff from time to time. But Ross understands getting the ball across the goal line. And I think he'd be very focused on how you make the bureaucracy better, how you make it work. Would there be arguments from time to time? Yes. Would there be controversy? Yes. Would there be changes? Yes.
And you'd see an administration, frankly, that would shake up the establishment. Let's don't kid ourselves. I think you'd see the administration shake up this government and make some drastic changes.
Interesting enough, he didn't last long enough on the largest corporations. They couldn't put up with it. Can you imagine anybody being paid to get rid of somebody $700 million? You've got to be pretty much of a pain in the neck. We can't pay to get rid of a president we don't want. We just wait 4 years.
If you're with Ross Perot, you're a hero. If you're against Ross Perot, you're not merely wrong, but you're evil. You're an enemy. And you're a dupe of the other side.
The most important thing for Americans to know about Ross Perot is that the country would probably not self-destruct under his leadership.
Peter Jennings reporting, Who is Ross Perot? Brought to you by Surf. With Surf, your laundry doesn't just look clean, it is clean.